your turn to speak. We do a lot of blah, blah, blah afterwards, and so it's your opportunity to speak unfettered. And I should also, for folks following along at home and folks who are here today, relative to the budget discussion, because of essentially a scheduling snafu, we will not be discussing the budget tonight. Instead, when we go into session, we're going to negotiate as to when the best time to convene to discuss the budget. But if you have comments and thoughts about the budget, and we're expecting to speak at a public hearing, we are going to reschedule that. It's most likely going to be on the 23rd. But if you can't contain yourself and you still want to share and speak to those points, you're welcome to also during public comment. So, we'll start with Myla Cabot-Zinn, please.
Thank you. My name is Myla Cabot-Zinn. I live at 21 West Center Street in Florence. My husband and I just moved here in November. We lived in Lexington, Massachusetts for 30 years, and I was the chair of the street lighting, the Lexington Lighting Options Committee for a number of years. And so when I noticed in the front page article in the Gazette, it was my first awareness that you folks were wrestling with this issue of changing over your system, and I felt, even though you're far along in the process, it's not the end of the process, and on the hope that you might still be able to make some changes in your choices, I would like to just read a brief statement that I have. So, I took a look at your streetlights the other night, and I have to say I was really dismayed by the amount of bright and visible light that comes from the light source, which it's really an unfortunate amount of glare and light spill. This is really not necessary. In this day and age, it's an easy way to go to not have the light source tucked into the fixture, but it's the consequences of it are that actually your visual acuity is impaired. And for people actually as they get older, it's even more important not to have that happen. So this is not a small issue, it's a big issue. You're going to be living with these street lights for a long time. They last a long time. So taking a little bit more time to see what ways you can either modify the lights you've chosen to put shields, light shields on them, or choosing fixtures from the list, and I think those fixtures are on the list that Chris Mason is using, that tuck the light source into the fixture a little more would make a huge difference. Also, not overlighting. Lighting enough. You want to light enough so that you can see, but if there's too much light, that also impairs visual acuity. And nighttime safety is very important. So when people are driving and they're hit by glare from streetlights, that actually affects safety. So I just would like you to consider, I worked in the town of Lexington. The head of our DPW is now actually a lighting consultant, and I've looked at some of the options that are available to you that, as I said, are on the list, and I think that I think you have much better choices, and that just taking just a sort of a pause in your process, you could end up with streetlights that save you money and energy, increase safety and visual acuity, and don't destroy the peaceful and lovely character of your town. So thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. Jasper Lapiansky, please.
I was worried you were going to leave that on and then would beep just as I got up here.
No. We have the technology to reset it. So you're all set.
Yes, but just like the previous speaker pointed out, not all technology that is available is used.
You have
certainly
the floor.
Not all the time.
You have the floor.
My name is Jasper Lapiansky. I live at 43 West Street. I am sure that this ground was covered 2 or 3 weeks ago, however many weeks ago there was a meeting. I wasn't here. I'm going to cover it now. I believe that the resignation of Jesse Adams leaves a void in the council, in the politics of Northampton, because Jesse did something for us that is not unique to him, is not, certainly not unique to Northampton, but there isn't enough of it. I certainly think there could be a lot more. And that was thinking. Jesse was the opposite of a rubber stamp. He voted yes on most things, but he had a critical view of it. He made amendments. He asked questions. He was interested in where the problem was and why that was the solution. Thoughtful governance is not the same thing as regular governance. And we don't have a lot of it anymore. So my hope is that whoever fills his seat, whether they reside in these chambers tonight or not, is willing to rise to the challenge to be someone like that. And I think one of the ways that they can go a long way towards showing that is to do things, and I know I'm combining two topics, but I only took a minute and a half on that one. So I think you could go a long way towards showing that, whoever it is, by not spending your time and your energy on the council introducing non-binding resolutions that accomplish nothing. For instance, there's one on the calendar tonight regarding Indigenous Peoples Day. Now, I did not have the chance to inquire as to why it's coming up in June. With that aside, I would suggest that those of you who put your time and effort into drafting this resolution would have been better off putting your time and effort into doing something that actually improved the lives of Indigenous people, or even one Indigenous person. Perhaps we could do something like what Plymouth does and have a giant Indigenous people's rally downtown every year. I don't know what the answer is, but I know that there is not a single Indigenous or other kind of person whose life will be improved or affected by the resolution before you tonight, and I hope that all of you abstain, because it is meaningless. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have no one else signed up. Is anyone interested in speaking? Because you may.
Sure.
Step up and identify yourself.
Hi, I'm Ann Jascott. I'm a resident of Northampton, live on Florence Road. And I'm also here to talk about the new lighting the city is considering. So I heard just a bit of your talk, and I hope to just add my own viewpoint on that. So first of all, thank you all for soliciting public input on such an important decision. I really appreciate that. I think these lights are quite an undertaking and could be with us for a long time. So I just want to make sure that we do it right. I've personally found the fixtures very unpleasant to look at, with a lot of glare, and I think we can do better than this. I think the city can look a lot more beautiful with other lighting and can be safer. My own personal experience with this sort of thing, I'm just recently moved in the past year from an apartment complex that had some very bright white and fairly unshielded lights. And I can say as a resident, it was really unpleasant to sleep next to those things. Even with the blinds down, there was a lot of illumination in my room. And approaching the apartment complex too, I found it was hard to see, for instance, ice on the ground. And I'm just concerned about a repeat of similar situations for residents and pedestrians and drivers in Northampton. Approaching these lights, as I got closer, I found a lot of glare and could even see the bulbs, which isn't good. So I think the other speaker mentioned shielding would be better. And I think that would be a benefit for all residents, pedestrians, and drivers. As you can tell, I'm fairly young, so it's only going to be worse for someone who's elderly walking around the city. Let's see. Also, yeah, I would also encourage you to think about lower lighting levels. I think that would enable us to use these lights as efficiently as possible. So shielding would direct all the light downwards where we need it, and lower light levels would allow us to save money as well. And if we're using shielding, we can get by with lower light levels because it's all being directed where we need it. So I would just encourage the city to look into as many options as possible with these lights. I want the ones that we pick to be good, a good investment that we can live with for a long time. and that will be as economically and energy efficient as possible and as safe and beautiful as possible. And so I think that we can and should do better than the current options. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Rachel Naismith from Florence, and I was involved in the writing of the Indigenous Peoples Resolution, and I would not have been involved in writing that if I didn't think it could improve people's lives. I think that we improve people's lives through education, education of children, and education of adults. I think that the idea of having an Indigenous Peoples Day that is recognized, that is publicized, that is discussed on school committees is the opportunity for all of us to become better educated of the history, the incredible history of this town, and to become more sensitive to issues overall. I feel that there could be a rally every year downtown. There could be special programs in the schools. There could be special programs on the local radio. I don't feel any of that's going to happen if we don't at least make a start. And in my mind, this is a start. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else wish to speak at this time? Okay. I'm going to ask the administrative assistant to please call the roll.
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor Dwight?
Here.
Councilor Klein?
Present.
Councilor Labarge?
Present.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Here.
Councilor Scherer?
Here.
We have a quorum, and before we get to the business at hand, as you understand that we're going to have to schedule probably two special meetings, there's a few options here. Currently, we're looking at the 23rd at 7 o'clock here in these chambers for the public hearing, and then followed by a finance committee meeting, and then by a vote. One of the options that we can do is we have a normally regularly scheduled meeting on the 16th. We can cancel that meeting and replace it with the 23rd meeting, which would make a longer agenda similar to what we have now. It does create some complications with some of the appointment issues because, as you know, we also have a very narrow calendar period in which we can approve the appointments once they come, once they're referred back out of committee. But and then also we have another the opportunity for a second vote. We're considering the 28th because there are two meetings scheduled for that day anyway, City Services and the Finance Committee meeting. We would, it would, in lieu of the Finance Committee meeting, we would assemble as the full council to vote a second time on the budget. Any thoughts? I entertain any thoughts or suggestions, but Councilor Carney.
I guess I just need to have a clarification maybe from Pam about that time. So we would have taken up the recommendations from the Committee on City Services at the meeting of June 16th. We would have taken up those 9 appointments.
Right.
Will that put us beyond the window if we meet on the 23rd?
Right, and so by ordinance, it would, or by charter, it would actually, they would become approved by virtue of no council vote.
I see. And
it's a 45-day window, and which expires previously.
Right. And ordinarily, it would just they would appear under the consent agenda on the 16th.
Correct.
And so on the 16th, it's actually 43 days,
which is within the 45. Okay. As chair of that committee on city services, I would be okay with it. I don't expect that there would be, I just don't expect that there would be any no recommendations from that group of people. And so I wouldn't insist that we meet on the 16th for the purpose of taking up those 8 names. I think that we'll still take them up on you know, for, as a matter of course, on our meeting, which is next Monday, or next
June 7th.
We'll still take them up. And if there's a way that, for the record, whether our recommendation will still be able to be entered in for the record, even though we won't vote on that, I'll kind of look toward my colleagues to see if they feel like it's necessary to meet on the 16th for that purpose. I mean, the full council meeting.
Councilor Dunn?
Yeah, no, I agree with the chair of the committee. I think that's a sensible path to take.
So we're meeting on the 16th?
So we would go ahead and forego the meeting. We would skip the meeting on the 16th and instead have the meeting on the 23rd as was suggested by the chair.
So full agenda on the 23rd, which would look very similar to the agenda today that we're not doing. So it will be long. It'll be a long agenda for the 23rd, but you buy a week. All right. I've seen nodding heads. I'm going to take those as essentially consensus. And so we will have a public hearing on the 23rd for the purpose of the public to weigh in and discuss the proposed FY 2017 budget presented by the mayor. And the public is invited to be here in these chambers at 7 o'clock on the 23rd, Thursday. Okay. All righty. So now comes the time for 1 minute announcement. So I'd like to start by saying you have a notification from Pam relative to these desks. These desks are very, very old. They're over 100 and some odd years old and actually have historic value. And but contained in the drawers here, there's a number of committees and councils historically who have stored candy wrappers, valuable items, documents. They got to get cleared out. I found a bolt and two clips in these drawers and some candy wrappers and some and a broken.
Can we auction off what we find to make some money?
I feel uncomfortable there because you are selling city property. By dint of the fact that it's in the stuff. Councilor Carney.
Well, I would just note that most of the desks do have, you know, some memorabilia etched into the drawers themselves.
We've discussed that and with Dave Pomerantz of City Services, and we are going to figure out some kind of way to preserve. You have autographs in these things dating back 120 years ago.
1846.
So I have a Nader LaDuke sticker in here.
I got a Fiker in mine.
You got a Fiker. So, Councilor Shara.
While people are rifling through their desks, can I go back and ask a question about the change? Are we going to be voting twice on the budget on that day?
No. Well, the 23rd will be the first vote, and then the
28th.
And the 28th would be the
second vote. Okay.
And on the 28th, we'll be convening most likely at 5 o'clock, and I believe, but we'll nail that down, but at 5 o'clock for the second meeting.
Agenda.
And the agenda item is the vote on the budget, and that's it.
Okay, so Tuesday the 28th, 5 o'clock.
In these chambers.
Okay. And I'll just remember that meeting will be happening right after our Committee on City Services.
Mm-hmm. If the City Services so should run late. We will convene as soon as yours.
We will have a departmental report followed by taking up of, I believe we'll also be taking up some appointments, about eight or nine of them.
We'll also be voting on the financial orders for the second, not just approving the budget, but all the related financial orders. Okay.
Okay, so we're all set in the desk, we're all set in the budget. Anyone else have 1 minute announcements?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
I just want to thank the five young girls who were our students at JFK for marching and holding our City Council Mayor banner on Memorial Day. I want to thank Katie Sullivan, Shea Crother, Emma Kellogg, Rochelle Parent, and Juliana Lucier. And they looked awesome and they did an excellent job. And thank you.
Thank you. Any other 1 minute?
I guess since we're not having the council meeting on the 16th, I'll announce that the second of the community resources public forums on the downtown economy will be on Monday, the 20th at 5:30 here in these chambers, and that's with a focus on workers' issues.
Anyone else? Okay. Communications and proclamations from the mayor, and he has proclamations.
Yes, I do. I have just two proclamations this evening. One of them is entitled Gypsy Jazz Week, June 14th through the 19th of 2016. I'm glad, definitely glad I'm reading it tonight since there won't be a council meeting that week. Whereas during the third week in June, since the year 2004, Northampton, Massachusetts has hosted the Gypsy Jazz Music Camp known as Django in June. And whereas Django in June is one of three centers of Gypsy Jazz in the entire United States, New York City and Puget Sound's Whidbey Island Django Fest being the other two. And whereas each year during the third week of June, Northampton is the center of Gypsy Jazz nationwide, attracting many of the world's best players. And whereas over 200 musicians from around the globe will be gathering in Northampton from June 14th through June 19th to study and perform Gypsy Jazz in the tradition of legendary Gypsy guitarist Django Reinhardt. And whereas in addition to Gypsy Jazz, Northampton is a proud mecca and host for many other musical genres and encourages all music lovers everywhere to visit our beautiful city and enjoy great music. And so now, therefore, I, David Narkowitz, mayor of the city of Northampton, do hereby proclaim June 16th through the 21st of 2016 as Gypsy Jazz Week and encourage all residents to appreciate and support this musical tradition. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and imprinted the city seal this 14th day of June 2016. And we do have this evening Andrew Lawrence, who is the director of this festival, and I'd like to present the proclamation to him. We have to look over at your cameraman. Excellent. Thanks, Zane. So I'll give that to you, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Let me just offer you, this is our poster. You've been looking at these posters for maybe 13 years now. And
thank you.
These proclamations just began last year, and thank you so much. I really appreciate the recognition. I'd also like to offer the city a recently produced 8-CD set, all of Django Reinhardt's earliest recordings with his best-known sideman, a violinist by the name of Stefan Grappelli, were recently remastered. And I'd love for these to go to the high school music library or whatever.
Definitely.
I'll leave it to you.
Definitely.
Okay?
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I have one more.
You have one more. Okay.
One more proclamation, yes. Switching gears. So this is actually a proclamation entitled National Gun Violence Awareness Day. And you'll note I'm wearing an orange tie, and I have a special Mayors Against Gun Violence pin that many of my colleagues around the country are sporting today. And many of us are also issuing proclamations on this day, June 2nd, 2016, National Gun Violence Awareness Day. Whereas today is recognized as National Gun Violence Awareness Day to honor and remember all victims and survivors of gun violence. And whereas every day 91 Americans are killed by gun violence and the lives of countless others are injured. And whereas Americans are 25 times more likely to be murdered with guns than people in other developed countries. And whereas on January 29th, 2013, a 15-year-old Chicago teen was killed a week after she marched in the presidential inaugural parade, which started a movement to honor the teen by wearing orange, the color hunters wear to announce themselves to other hunters, a color that symbolizes the value of human life. And whereas by wearing orange today, Americans will raise awareness about gun violence and honor the lives and lost human potential of Americans' lives stolen by gun violence. And whereas the city supports continued local, state, and national efforts to strengthen gun safety and educate the community on safe gun storage, and so now, therefore, I, Mayor David J. Narkowitz, do hereby proclaim today, June 2nd, 2016, to be National Gun Violence Awareness Day in the city of Northampton. In witness whereof, I have set my hand and affixed the seal of the city of Northampton. So I did want to also thank, there were several citizens who also filled out an online petition that the national organization, Everytown USA, that's affiliated, that's sort of affiliated with Mayors Against Gun Violence, had been circulating around the country, and we got several signatures from local citizens who are also very supportive of this effort. So there you have it.
Do you have a URL?
You can go to URL, I think everytown.org will get you there, or Mayors Against Gun Violence, or Mayors Against Illegal Guns will get you there. I did post a brief YouTube video about, specifically about the young woman who was killed, and sort of the, a lot of her teen peers decided to come up with this thing about wearing orange, and now it's sort of been adopted as a national campaign. So there's a lot of information on my Twitter feed and Facebook page about it as well. Okay.
Okay. So we move to resolutions, and this is second reading. Item 16.093 is a resolution recognizing the second Monday of October as Indigenous Peoples Day. This is a second reading. Accept a motion to put forward.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Well, I just want to say thank you to my fellow councilors for passing this unanimously in first reading. I'm really proud that happened. I also have gotten word from folks on the school committee that they're going to be introducing a similar resolution there, so that there is some momentum with this resolution. And I think when the school committee passes such a thing, it will really help to kind of institute some a real cultural shift in the education in the city for kids around kind of learning about the Indigenous peoples of this region. And I mentioned last time that I think there are something like 22 cities now that have passed similar resolutions. And I think that that represents a really significant cultural shift in the country, that we're really starting to figure out ways to take responsibility for, as a kind of ruling class of white people in this country, we're starting to think about how to take responsibility for acknowledging the Indigenous peoples who were here before before Columbus came to the United States. And I just want to thank again the co-sponsor, Maureen Carney, and Rachel Naismith, a resident of Ward 7, and just say that, again, this was kind of a perfect, for me, a perfect confluence of constituent interest and interest here on the council. Thank you so much for initiating this and working on this, Rachel. And I also want to thank the Human Rights Commission. We don't have anyone here from the Human Rights Commission, but they also supported this and are co-sponsors. Thank you, and I hope that we can see a unanimous vote again tonight.
Any other discussions? Okay, this is a resolution, it's a voice vote. So all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? That passes unanimously in the second reading. Blessedly, there are no presentations. We come to the consent agenda that includes the approval of minutes of May 19, 2016 of the City Council meeting. Also approving 16.109, the petition for secondhand dealer's license for Birdhouse Music, formerly Instrument Exchange, located at 164 Main Street. And then item 16.110, petition to accept a portion of Pleasant Street / Route 5. That's to refer to the Planning Board, City Council Committee on Public Works and Utilities, and the Public Works Commission. And item 16.113, appointments to committees, and this is to refer to the City Council Committee on City Services. Reappointments to the Board of Registrars, that's Charles Klopacki of 26 Ferry Avenue, Janet Larson of 982 Florence Road in Florence. A reappointment to the Central Business Architecture Committee, Bruce Gravisky of 23 Ice Pond Drive in Florence. A reappointment to the Disability Commission, Hannah Coyle of 3 Hampton Avenue. Appointment to the Disability Commission, Judith Kimberly of 659 Park Hill Road in Florence. An appointment to the Housing Partnership of Greta Hagen of 16 Market Street, number 2C. And also, lastly, a reappointment to the Housing Partnership, Gordon Shaw, 582 Haydenville Road in Leeds. I'll accept
a motion.
Motion's made and seconded. All those in favor of moving the consent agenda, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Now we recess for an abbreviated finance committee meeting chaired by Councilor Murphy.
Just two items tonight. So, Pam, would you call our roll, please? Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
First item is the approval of our minutes of both May 5th and May 19th, 2016. We got a motion on those?
To approve. Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And we have only two financial orders tonight. First one is 16114, in order to grant VAC a 5% TIF exemption on new growth beginning in FY18, whereas the City of Northampton granted a 5-year 5% tax increment financing agreement to VCA Inc. in 2008 for the relocation of its custom furniture and architectural millwork business from East Hampton to Northampton and the construction of a new 20,000 square foot manufacturing facility located on the south campus of the former Northampton State Hospital at 209 Earl Street. And whereas VCA Inc. has satisfied the terms of its original TIF agreement by expanding its workforce from 15 to 18 employees as specified in the agreement, and whereas VCA Inc. has since grown to 30 employees and now wishes to further expand its operation through the construction of a 13,000 square foot addition at its 209 Earl Street facility with a commitment to add 6 additional employees, and whereas this is important manufacturing expansion and it's received preliminary approval from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts as an eligible Massachusetts State Investment Tax Credit project subject to the approval of the local tax increment financing agreement. And so now, therefore, it be ordered that the City of Northampton approves a VCA, the City Council approves a VCA expansion project as a certified project within the Village Hill at Hospital Hill Economic Opportunity Area and grants a 5% TIF exemption on new growth for a period of 5 years beginning in fiscal year 18 and authorizes the mayor to execute and implement the TIF agreement. Do we have a motion of finance?
A motion. Second.
Okay. And the mayor's here to talk about it.
Yes. The resolution kind of lays out the chronology. Tony Clark and Bruce Foltz, two woodworkers who started out, they're both, I think, Leeds school graduates, and started a company that originally started in East Hampton, and they expanded and actually became one of the first commercial businesses at Village Hill on the South Campus on Earl Street. They have been experiencing significant growth. This is actually sort of a mid-phase of their growth plan. They're actually planning to acquire some additional property adjacent to their current parcel, and down the road may even be doing a further expansion. But they are going to do this manufacturing expansion. It's a 13,000 square foot addition to their building, and they're committing to adding, it's 5 to 10 jobs, but they're going to commit to 6. And they've actually have been going through the state's tax incentive program and have been pre-qualified to receive significant state tax credits. But in order to be eligible for those tax credits, they have to be given a local TIF. And so we're basically proposing doing exactly what we did back in 2008, a somewhat symbolic TIF, if you will, a 5% per year reduction on the new growth. So it's not on their overall tax bill. I did ask Joan Serafin to kind of do a rough projection of what that might be, sort of extrapolating from their current facility. She's, again, this is all just an estimate until it's actually built. Using the income approach, she's estimating that the value of the new 13,000 square foot new growth expansion would be a little over $1 million, $1,094,264.50, to be accurate, and that basically the discount on the taxes per year on that new growth would be about $884 off of their taxes on the new growth. That's what the TIF would represent for 5 years. But again, for them, it gives them access to state tax credits that they'll be able to take advantage of. In the previous project, they got not only state tax credits, they also got state bond financing for mass development. So again, these tax incentives are primarily to try to encourage manufacturing, which is something that is, you know, always a challenge to try to retain and expand here in the city. So I'm very supportive of granting them this TIF, particularly since it'll give them access to the state credits. So I'd ask for the council's approval.
Okay. Questions for the mayor?
No.
Council? So obviously the previous TIF that we granted expired.
It was a 5-year, again, and very much the same situation. You know, they were making a much larger investment at the time, and were you know, receiving financing, preferred financing from the state as well as tax credits. So,
and their projected business plan sounds like, with the incremental but substantial growth that they have anticipated, do you suspect that they'll be soliciting an extension of the TIF or another TIF?
I don't know that. It's they're currently in negotiations with Mass Development. There's sort of where they are on Earl Street. There's where they're located on Earl Street, and then there's actually another development pad sort of adjacent to it. I think they're in negotiations with trying to secure that. And in the short term, when they put the addition onto their building, they'll probably use some of that lot to supplement the lost parking. But I also think they're, you know, trying to be optimistic and planning for the future, that they might be adding another something more in the future. But it's really still in the planning stages.
Previously, when we granted TIFs, I mean, sometimes our TIFs were, and we've actually rescinded a few in the end. But this project seems like it is the prototype of TIF incentive programming. That, I mean, in the past we've actually worked some to make it work, and it hasn't always worked. In this instance, we already have a proven track record with a company that's mm-hmm. already benefited from it. It's stayed local, it's expanding, and it's providing local jobs, which is what incentivizing that is for.
Exactly.
And it is manufacturing, something that's actually become an increasing rarity in the country, if certainly not this region. It's actually manufacturing American-made products with American labor and resources. So,
and we do track the TIFs once these agreements are signed. We do monitor them. The state monitors them. There's annual reporting that's done, and I know a prior administration did rescind a TIF, and then I've rescinded a TIF during my time. Again, just because of not meeting the job targets. Right. Although I would say, you know, they're fairly small TIFs, so it was not, you know, repaying it was not a major burden for them.
Right. Sometimes the onus,
the state comes dealing with the state was a different issue. But anyway, so,
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, I remember when we approved this TIF before, Mayor, mm-hmm. and I have to say that they have done well with their agreement, from 15 to 18 employees, then now 30, and now expanding again. I think that it's a great business that we have here in Northampton, and I think they will deserve to be able to have that TIF.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Bidwell.
I would just pile on with the appreciation for this particular organization. They're wonderful folks. These are the kind of jobs we want in Northampton. These are the kind of businesses we want expanded. It's in the right location. $1 million added to our tax base. Mm-hmm. This is what a TIF is supposed to do, and it's really good news.
Mm-hmm. And I know that I also know that I'm fairly confident Bruce Voltz isn't going anywhere, because if those of you have seen the two condos that are being built, like right around the corner from his plant on Grove Street, he's actually building those and is going to live there. So he's one of the tenants of that. So but that's his project that he's also investing in personally. So he's definitely they're both longtime Northampton residents, and this they do some of the most high end furniture and woodworking in the United States, including have done Bill Gates's homes in Washington State and New York and all around the country. Some pretty amazing stuff. Mm-hmm. And they do you know, hire really at well, good wages, high wages, and so it's a good company.
Mm-hmm. So any other questions on this one? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Nope. Good. And now we're going to re-accept Scanlon Avenue. On the recommendation of the mayor, order that whereas petition has been duly filed to lay out and accept Scanlon Avenue as a public way, and whereas the petition has been referred to the planning board and to the Board of Public Works, and whereas the Board of Public Works has held a duly noticed public hearing on the petition to the layout and accept the public way, and whereas both the Planning Board and the Board of Public Works have recommended laying out and accepting Scanlon Avenue as a public way. Now, therefore, it be ordered the City Council authorizes the acquisition by gift, purchase, eminent domain, or otherwise, an easement in and over parcels of land shown as Scanlon Avenue on a plan entitled Plan and Land of Northampton, Massachusetts, Hampshire County, surveyed for the City of Northampton, dated July 29, 2014, for the purpose of laying out, establishing, and accepting public ways thereon. Further, the City Council hereby lays out, establishes, and accepts as a public way the parcels to be acquired hereunder, and further, that no damages shall be payable as a result of any taking authorized herein, and no betterment shall be assessed as a result of the layout, establishing, and accepting such a public way. Do we have a motion in finance?
I have a motion. Second.
Second. Discussion on this one.
The most accepted street in the City of Northampton. It's been accepted twice.
Yes.
Yes.
If at first you don't succeed, accept it again. No questions on this one? All right, and all in favor of a positive recommendation
aye.
Of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No. Very good. And I know no other business that we're going to do tonight.
One other financial transfer that's not part of the budget.
Did one?
That is, it is on here. Yeah.
Which one is that?
It's a financial order to, it's to, let's.
The revolving fund.
It's number I.
16.102
16.100
100
right. Fiscal stability stabilization.
I have an earlier version, maybe.
Stabilization
600,000 from general.
Yes.
Fund.
Yep. Okay.
It's from.
And upon the recommendation of the mayor, in order to appropriate $600,000 from the FY16 general fund to fiscal stability stabilization fund. And to a regular stabilization fund. Order that $600,000 be appropriated from the FY16 general fund undesignated fund balance to the following accounts: $200,000 to the fiscal stability stabilization fund and $400,000 to the regular stabilization fund. Do we have a motion in finance?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second. And the mayor can discuss it.
Yes, so this is basically something that we do at the end of the year. We're now getting to the close of the fiscal year, and our free cash or undesignated fund balance must close and goes away on June 30th. So we're trying to take the opportunity to move some of that free cash into our existing stabilization funds. So we are proposing to move 200 into the fiscal stability stabilization fund, which sort of fits with our overall plan, and then 400 into the stabilization fund. We're partially benefiting in some ways from the light winter because it may have been typical in other winters that we had to come to you in April to move 400,000 to the snow and ice account, which we obviously didn't have to do. So we want to put this into stabilization and also in some ways replaces the money that we took for the Parks and Rec building, which we had to take out of stabilization last year because free cash wasn't available. So we had to take it out of stabilization in order to be able to fund the Parks and Rec building. So in some ways we're sort of replacing that 400,000 that we took out of stabilization last year. So that's the rationale for dividing this up. It will leave us after you pass the budget, or hopefully pass the budget, or at least some of the cash capital items in the budget, It would leave us a total remaining balance of about $126,000, closing out the year in free cash, which would then just close as part of free cash and again come back to us. But it would at least leave some balance to get us through the remaining month of the year should any emergencies arise.
Questions for the mayor on this?
Snowstorms or, you know, anything like that that might happen. Freak snowstorms.
I'm not seeing any questions, so all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance,
aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. So with that, I know of nothing else on our agenda or anything unexpected, so a motion to adjourn.
Close it. Second.
Aye. Oh. Thank you.
Okay, and we convene back into regular session now. So why don't we start then with item 16.100, the financial order to appropriate $600,000 from FY 16 general fund to the fiscal stability stabilization fund and stable.
Second.
Second. Any further discussion on this item? Pam, roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Blake?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading, and we will revisit it on the 23rd. Okay, so let me see. Where does that leave us here? I believe we're up to item O, 16.108. Once again, this is the order to accept Scanlon Avenue once again as a city street formally approved by the City Council on December 3rd, 2015. There's been a request for two readings, but I'll accept the motion first to put it on the floor.
To approve.
Second.
Okay, maybe you're curious as to why we're doing this again. I think it's reasonable curiosity if you are. There was a failure to register, right, in the Registry of Deeds, and the time has expired.
It's 30 days from the time.
30 days. So hopefully
register at this point.
They'll hopefully register at this time. But because it has lapsed, we're required to approve it once more. So just, there's no controversy associated with this, just it's a do-over. So any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Yes.
Suspend rule.
And the motion passes in first reading. There's been a motion to suspend rules and a second. This is to allow for a second reading. Any discussion on the suspension of rules?
Council. I'd like to know why we're asking for a second. We're being asked for a second reading, I should say.
To finally execute this in a more prompt fashion, to have it's. The request for second reading was, I presume, was to file for this as soon as possible.
We want to get it filed properly with the Registry of Deeds within 30 days.
Yeah.
You've now just set your next meeting for the 23rd.
Right. The clock starts ticking as of this first vote.
Yeah. So
and that gives another now.
We've already voted for it and approved it once, so it's just a technicality. So we'd like to just get it finally registered so that the street is recognized.
Any further discussion on the suspension of rules? This is on the suspension of rules. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions?
Move second reading.
Second.
Seconded for second reading. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Blake?
Yes. All right, that passes in second reading.
I just wanted to make sure, because I think you, as in the finance committee, you went past that $600,000 transfer under financial orders.
We did vote that. That
was finance. We did
in finance. You did, but you skipped over it during, or is it in a different?
I just did. That was the vote we just did previous to this one.
Didn't I?
Oh,
yeah,
yes.
We did.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
It was the first thing. The first thing I did right out of finance.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
She was concerned.
So. It's no.
It's so fast.
I know. And we're fast and stunning and riveting. I understand, Susan. It's okay. So yes. Now and we're back to second readings here. There we go. This is item 16.081. This is to appropriate $39,353.78 for related infrastructure upgrades relative to the replacement of the city's voiceover IP system. Second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion on this? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shea?
Yes.
Councilor Bigelow?
Yes.
Councilor Kearney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item 16.082, this is a financial order to authorize Look Park to apply for a PARC, P-A-R-C grant and authorize related borrowing.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Okay, that passes in second reading. Now we have the financial orders regarding the Community Preservation Committee recommendations for funding, and this is second reading. Do you want to move them as a group?
We move them as a group.
Okay, motions to move them as a group.
Second.
That's item 16.083, stained glass window restoration for First Churches, $213,000. Item 16.084, the Sawmill Hills Open Space Acquisition, Northampton Conservation Commission, $72,000. Item 16.085, the historic scenic curtain restoration at the Academy of Music, $44,785. Item 16.086, supportive housing for homeless youth, Friends of Hampshire County Homeless Individuals, $275,000. Item 16.087, Conservation Northampton Conservation Commission, $30,000. Item 16.088, Fitzgerald Lake Invasive Plant Control, Broadbrook Coalition, $12,800. Item 16.089, Shepherd Barn Dendrochronology Study, Historic Northampton, $2,300. And item 16.090, Pulaski Park Renovation Expansion, Northampton Department of Public Works, $805,400.
Like to pull one of them out.
So you want, I'm guessing you want item 16.088 to be pulled out of the group. Okay, so all the other items that I iterated there, with the exception of 16.088, we are voting. So any discussion on those items?
Second.
Don't worry about it. I'll just say I'm all over.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Any discussion on these items as a group? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
And I'm going to abstain because there's one of them that I can't vote on, so yeah. I'll just abstain on all of them.
All right, now item 16.088, that, by the way, that passes in second reading. This is item 16.088, the Fitzgerald Lake Invasive Plant Control, Broadbrook Coalition, $12,800. Accept a motion.
Approve.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call, please.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Klein? I'm sorry. Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
No.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in second. Item 16.091, this is the financial order to allow the city's tree warden to accept gifts of $25,000 or less in second reading.
Second.
Second.
Made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Kearney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Shannon? Yes.
Passes second reading. Now we're on to orders, and this is the first. Yes.
Why can't we vote on 16.104? Is that attached to the budget? The firing range?
104.
It's a capital project.
It's a capital project. That's okay. So we have the option to proceed with capital expenditures, but I thought it was appropriate to just unfold it all in. For simplicity's sake, if nothing else. So on this order, 16.104, 111, a warrant to hold a special preliminary election on July 7, 2016 for the at-large city council seat. And this is a first reading. And this is upon the recommendation of the city clerk, Wendy Mazza. And that's to hold a special primary election on July 7, 2016 for the at-large city council seat. Order that the special preliminary election be held on Thursday, the 7th day of July 2016, the following polling places designated by the council as follows. Ward 1, Precinct A in Jackson Street School Auditorium, as well as Precinct B. Ward 2, Precinct A in Smith Vocational Agricultural High School, as the same as Precinct B for Ward 2. Ward 3 in Precinct A in the Senior Center, Great Room at 67 Conn Street. Same thing applies for Precinct B in Ward 3. Ward 4, Precinct A in the Senior Center of the Great Room at 67 Conn Street, as well as Precinct B. Ward 5, Precinct A, that's in the Florence Civic and Business Building at 90 Park Street. Ward 5, Precinct B, is in Smith Vocational Agricultural High School. Ward 6, Precincts A and B in Robert K. Finn Ryan's Road School. And Ward 7, Precinct A in John F. Kennedy Middle School and Community Room. And Precinct B in Lead School Gymnasium lower level. And the polls will be open at 7 o'clock in the forenoon and close at 8 o'clock in the evening of the said day. And all such voters will, within the said hours, in the precinct in which they are individually entitled to vote, given their votes for councilor at large to fill a vacancy. So, accept a motion.
Accept the motion.
Mr. President.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion?
At the risk of receiving ridicule from my colleagues for showing an overabundance of caution, I'm going to recuse myself from discussion on this item. So, I'm just going to
turn up
a brief walk. So,
consider yourself ridiculed.
Thank you.
And we'll keep pause. Councilor Bidwell.
Since we are not meeting on the 16th, do we foul up any timetables by waiting for a second?
That's a problem.
That's a good question.
For a longer period of time, and is there any particular reason why we wouldn't waive rules and do a second reading?
I don't see why not. It's not I've never heard of any objections being raised to establishing an election and setting a date for an election. But that's a good point. I don't know for sure, but.
City clerk was aware that you'd be canceling the meeting.
Exactly.
Right.
We should do two readings.
Yeah. I think
I'd hate to find out later that we.
Well, taking a cue from Councilor O'Donnell and exercising an excessive caution, I think that's advisable. So we'll do the first reading in any event. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, I went in and talked with Wendy and the girls in there, and plus I've had several people, counselor, talking to me about the cost and so forth. Yes, there is a cost to this election, but we need to look at Wendy and Amy and Mary Ellen and Gail. Talking to one of them has given up their vacation, and it's the time involvement here where they are really going to be straight out. And I think people need to understand this, and I think some of the counselors went in and said, thank you. Just thank you is going to mean a lot. And I go in and I talk with them, and to hear one tell me they could not even go on vacation. My question is, where are we going to go ahead and get this money? Wendy said she doesn't have it in her budget. Mayor, could you answer that?
Yeah, I've discussed this with the city clerk, and we did not budget for it because we don't. First of all, it came very late in the process, and number two, we don't know what the final cost would be, not even knowing if there'd be a preliminary or not. So I've assured the city clerk that we will come and move money into her budget, probably mid-year when free cash is certified. She has plenty of money to function through the year, and we will fully pay for the election. So that's never been a question.
I think it's kind of important to note that this is not a silly expense. This is actually critical and a necessary expense to people who consider it or have suggested that it's frivolous or costly. We are actually paying for the right of citizens to be engaged and invest in the democracy, which is critical. So I agree with you. I think the extra work that's being put on in the clerk's office to deal with an issue that was not of their making or anyone else's making. This is a situation that simply is, and it will come up again. It'll come up again historically. It is a necessary cost. It is not a frivolous cost. And I take issue with anyone who asserts differently. It's one of the most critical things that the clerk's office certainly does, and that we as a city and as a community within the United States, we invest in our elections and their right and just costs. So that said, I think, so we'll start with the first reading. Any other discussion on this item?
No.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Abstention.
Yes.
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 All right, that passes in first reading. I'll accept a motion to suspend rules.
Suspend the rule.
Second.
Okay, this is to allow for a second vote within session. So any discussion on the suspension of rules? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Second.
Motion's made in second for second reading. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
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 That passes in second reading. Councilor O'Donnell may come back into the room. Next up, we have item 16.112, and that's to approve amendments to the City of Northampton's Administrative Code, Part 2, Sections 20.0. The Public Works Commission, 23.0 Public Shade Tree Commission, and Section 1.03. This is the appointment of elected officials to serve on multiple member bodies, and this will require only one reading. I'm sorry. This is we have to announce a public hearing on this. That's right. Now, as it is, we would have scheduled the public hearing for the 16th, but now it's the 23rd. I don't know what that does to the mayor's schedule as far as the administrative orders. And I do know that we've actually just referred something to this committee already, and that there is pending something on their agenda already. So, Mayor.
If you're planning to hold the hearing and the vote on the same night, it could be the first meeting in July if you wanted to just get it away from these other
issues. Got it. Okay.
Issues. Yeah.
That's July, what, 16th?
14th. Unless we have a special meeting.
I just don't know what is there a requirement for how soon you have to hold the public hearing and vote on it?
Once we announce the public hearing.
Well, not even that, just from when I submit the order, is there a clock ticking? I'll have to look at the charter.
It's not by charter. The public hearing has to take place not more than 7, but less than 14 days. I'm sorry, not less than 7, but more than 14 days after the public hearing has been published in the newspaper.
Councilor Murphy has it? Oh, you have a MASH note somewhere written on the back of one of those things?
The treasure man.
Yeah. Did you put it in the recycling bucket?
Oh, was that what you wrote the note on? Oh, yeah, I did.
It's never a safe bet.
There you go.
There we go.
The secret plan.
So it is Article 6 is the administrative organization, Section 6, 1, Organization of City Agencies. The organization of the city and the operating agencies to provide services and administer the government may be accomplished only through an administrative order submitted by the city council to the city council by the mayor. No administrative order may originate with the city council. The mayor may, subject only to express prohibitions in the general law or this charter, submit proposals to reorganize, consolidate, or abolish a city agency in whole or in part, or to establish a new city agency is deemed necessary. But no function assigned by this charter to a particular city agency may be discontinued or assigned to any other city agency unless specified by this charter.
So it's 60 days.
60.
It's 60.
If you read down, it's 60 days.
Yeah.
It goes into effect if you don't act on it within 60 days.
Okay. Right.
So, okay. Further down.
Yeah, which, yes. And this is so effective. Notice will describe the scope of the proposal and the time and place at which the public hearing will be held, not less than 7 or no more than 14 days following the publication. And then, as you said, an organization or reorganization plan shall become effective at the expiration of 60 days following the date of the proposal submitted to the city council, unless the city council shall, by a majority vote within that 60-day period, vote to disapprove the plan. Only one vote is required. So
July would be your only opportunity, yeah, unless you had a second meeting in July, because it would be like July 27th or whatever would be 60 days, because I submitted it on May 27th.
Right. We'd have to have a special meeting.
No, I'm saying if you didn't want to have the hearing and the vote on the same night.
Right.
In July.
We could do that.
Right.
I see more nodding heads. So that seems to be the consensus there. So the first meeting.
Again, it's your preference. I don't want to, I think it'll be harder to schedule a second meeting in July, late July.
Yes.
It'll be, so.
Oh, God, I know. Although we did it last year. We had two special meetings in the summer last year, one in July and one in August. No one else planning to resign, I hope. Okay. All right. So why don't we schedule that for the first meeting in July then?
July 14th.
July 14th. Bastille Day in France, but we don't celebrate that here. So July 14th, the public hearing on the mayor's administrative order. So be it. So, okay. We don't need a vote on that. So, let's see, where am I at here? That was the election. That was the order. Oh, okay. Item 16.114, in order to grant VCA Incorporated a 5% TIF exemption on new growth beginning FY 2018. This is the first reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Councilor Bidwell.
Just a question about TIFs, just for my background. Is there any threshold as to a minimum amount that the TIF has to be in order to trigger the eligibility for the state tax credit? This strikes me as a
small
side.
Yeah, well, you saw that what it was, you know, back in 2008.
Right.
Now, they have not indicated that there's any threshold. So they just want to know that the city has some skin in the game and is willing, has also approved it as a project. And we've met with the owners, and they're really not looking for a local, significant local break. That wasn't their intent. They just want to.
Just to trigger the other.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any further discussion?
Okay.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
That passes in first reading, and we'll come up again on the 23rd. Now onto ordinances. 16.025, an ordinance regarding the parking on South Street. This is a second reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. Now item 16.061. This is an ordinance to establish 2 1-hour parking spaces in Florence on Main Street, the second reading.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we are at item 16.062. This is an ordinance to add, well, technically recognize, a yield sign at Venturers Field Road. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Counselor Martin?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Bidwell? Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Well, I'll be damned. There it is, 8:11. We have got through this meeting. I said I have no further announcements other than, you know, clean out your desk. Clean out your desk. There's no information requests, there's no new business, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Adjourn.
Those in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you all very much.
It's still light out.